I invite you now to take your copy of the Scriptures and turn again to Philippians chapter 1. In the very first chapter, we're going to finish up chapter 1 this morning with the title, Striving for the Gospel. Striving for the Gospel. If you take that title apart word by word, you can read it two different ways. It's not a striving against each other, it's a striving with each other, together in the same direction. Our text this morning is Philippians chapter 1, beginning with verse 27. And it reads like this. It says, "Only let your conduct be worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or an absent, I may hear of your affairs, that you stand fast in one spirit and one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel, and not in any way terrified by your adversaries, which is to them a proof of perdition, but to you of salvation, and that from God. For to you it has been granted on behalf of Christ not only to believe on Him, but also to suffer for His sake, having the same conflict which you saw in me, and now you hear is in me." Let's pray together. Father, thank you now again for your word. We ask and we pray as we open it up together that our hearts might be both quieted and stirred at the same time. Maybe we quieted from the things that are around us in our lives and in our thoughts, and may they be stirred by the Holy Word of God. We'll give you the praise for the glory of God. In Christ's name, amen. As we study the book of Philippians, the theme of the book of Philippians is the mind of the believer. And I hope you've seen that in chapter 1. How do you think? What do you think? What is your approach to life? What is your approach as a Christian to life around you? And Paul is dealing with these things. And he talks about in Philippians 2:5 that let this mind be in you which was also in Christ Jesus. And God has given us through Jesus Christ the ability to think like Christ thinks. Not that we understand all of His deity and have all of His attributes, but as far as how we approach the Christian life, how we approach our life in general, we should be approaching it as Christ would. Years ago, there was that WWJD, What Would Jesus Do? It was a little bit commercialized, it was overboard at sometimes, but the basic principle was there. And we ought to ask ourselves, how would we approach things? How would Jesus approach things? And chapter 1 is the gospel mind. The gospel mind. Next week, chapter 2, if you want to think ahead, it's the humble mind. But chapter 1 is the gospel mind. The focus in chapter 1 is the gospel of Jesus Christ. And let me encourage you this morning. Let me encourage you that are here as part of this church in Austin. And I hope this is true around the world, that we as Christians would be gospel-centered, that we would be locally minded with the gospel of Jesus Christ. What did we see today? We saw 40-some people or 30-some people killed in the last few days. Guess what? The economy no longer matters to them. You know what? Abortion no more matters to them. And what kind of health insurance doesn't matter to them. And what the weather is doesn't matter to them. And what foreign relationships are doesn't matter to them. The only thing that matters to those people is how did they respond to the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's it. Whether they had an SUV or a bicycle doesn't matter anymore. Whether they had good health insurance, bad health insurance, whether we are at war or at peace, doesn't matter. What's the gospel of Jesus Christ? That's what determines eternity. So chapter 1 is the gospel mind. And today our title is Striving for the Gospel. There's a reason Paul talks about striving here, and we'll see that in just a minute. But my question for this is, what do you strive for in your life? Usually when we think of strife, we think of adversarial. That's not what we're talking about this morning. Today we're going to talk about striving as far as our goal, and as far as our energy, as far as our direction, as far as our cooperation, and how we are working together and putting everything we have behind that. What are we aiming toward? What are we working toward in our lives? So what are you striving for in your life? What's your goal? What's your ambition? What's your long-term idea that you should be accomplishing for Jesus Christ? I want you to see, first of all, what Paul says here, to stand fast. And you're going to notice, and I always put a little subtitle there, with or explanation, with others. Look with me at verse 27. 27 is long. It says, "Only let your conduct be worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come to you and see you or am absent, I may hear of your affairs, and that you stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel." I could just stop right there and spend the whole morning on that verse. I could really do that. But he says there, he begins there, he talks about your conduct or in your life. And what he's talking about is your public actions as a church body. Ladies and gentlemen, that is crucially important. That is crucially important. What does the world see? What does the community see as our public actions as a church body? And when you're in the community, and when you're in the world, and when you're at your job, and when you're in your neighborhood, you are a reflection upon not only this church, but you're a reflection upon Jesus Christ as your Savior. And he says, so let your conduct, let your living be worthy or have value or worth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Okay, stop, pull the car over and park for a minute. Let your conduct, let your living, let your daily, whatever you do, be worthy or have the value and have the worth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Wow, if that doesn't put an anchor on your boat, I don't know what will. Is my life worthy of the eternal sacrifice for the sin of man? That's what he's saying. Let your conduct be worthy of the gospel of Christ, the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. And he says, let it be whether I am with you or whether I'm not. I have a number of my children sitting here in the congregation this morning. They could tell you stories, especially the boys. I'm sure the girls could too, but there's only one here to defend herself. So, but the boys, and I know sometimes that when they're present, and mom and dad are there to harangue them and harass them, and to, you know, to hold a gun to their head, it's a lot easier. What are they doing when mom and dad aren't around? What are we doing as believers when our spiritual leader or someone is not there of our group or our persuasion or our fellowship and they don't see it? Does our conduct, is it then worthy of the gospel of Jesus Christ, whether someone we think sees it or not? And he says here, he goes on in the verse, he says, so that I may come and see you, whether I'm absent, hear your affairs, that what? You stand fast in one spirit, one breath and one life, that you stand with one mind or one soul and one thinking, and that you strive together for the faith of Jesus Christ, your faith of the gospel. Now you say, he's just giving a general encouragement. Oh, no, he's not. He's giving a very specific and pointed reason. Because if you go over to chapter 4, he talks about two ladies. Two ladies, and their names are Eutychus and Syntyche. And these two ladies in the church could not get along. And they were at odds at each other, and they were bickering, quarreling, or disagreeing, or whatever. And it was so bad that it came back to the Apostle Paul's ears in jail in Rome. See, it's one thing that if you have somebody that's doing something and it's kept within a room and nobody breathes a sound of it. Let me tell you a little story from years ago. I had a couple in my church, and they both had children, and they were both divorced. And the lady had 5 children, the man had 2 children, and they were both, well, she was in her 30s, he was closer to 40. But one day, little 5-year-old Megan walked into my Sunday school class. I was teaching the 4- and 5-year-olds. She walked in and just announced, "We slept at Dan's house last night." I said, "Really? And where did your mommy sleep?" "In Dan's bed." Now, what did that tell me? Duh! I don't think that was a word back then. It didn't take 2 and 2 to make 4. Okay? I immediately knew what had happened. Because what? A 5-year-old, inquisitive, without any boundaries little girl, walks in and announces it to the whole Sunday school class. Unfortunately, there are 4- and 5-year-olds, and so they didn't realize what I understand. But her pastor was teaching her class. So at the end of church, when Diane was going out the door, I said, "Come here." Okay? Now you say, "Well, I do things when the kids aren't around." Well, good for you. Shouldn't be doing things. All right? Don't think that things aren't noticed. He says, stand fast and strive together, work together. You've got your differences. You know what, you two ladies? I heard about it. Your bickering and your fighting and your arguing is so bad that I heard about it all the way from Philippi to Rome. I didn't have a cell phone. It wasn't text. It wasn't tweeted. Okay? Paul heard about it in jail where he was, in stocks, in bonds, with Roman soldiers around. And Paul is writing and he says, "Now listen, I want you two to strive together. Not strive against each other, but be going together for the sake of the gospel, and let your testimony be that which represents the gospel of Jesus Christ. Stand fast with others. Stand in the right place." Number 2, stand strong with others. Verse 28. "And in not in any way terrified by your adversaries, which to them is a proof of perdition, but to you of salvation, that and that from God." You know what? You're going to have enemies. If you're a Christian this morning, if you know Jesus Christ as your Savior, you are going to have enemies. If you don't, something's wrong with you. I'll show you in just a minute. If you don't have some enemies, you need to get some. You really need to work on getting some enemies. Some of you are thinking, "Man, he's really cracked now. Too much chocolate. What did you do? Slip a little cocaine in there now?" No. Let me tell you something. If the world doesn't hate you, if Satan doesn't hate you, you're not doing something right. He says here in this verse, look what he says. He says, "And not in any way terrified by your adversaries, which to them is a proof of perdition." That word terrified means to be frightful or fearful and frightened by your adversaries. He says, don't be terrified. He says, now you're going to have adversaries. You're going to have enemies, but don't let that bother you. As a matter of fact, you ought to rejoice in it. Because he says, to them, it is a sign of perdition, or it's a sign of destruction. It is a sign that they're winning. Let me ask you something. Who's winning the Republican presidential nomination race? Now tell me, who is winning this morning? I'll tell you this. I can ask 4 people and get 4 different answers this morning. Okay, because everybody, and I heard that Santorum has a plan to capitalize and win Super Tuesday. Well, good, and Mitt Romney has his plan, and Newt Gingrich, I think he's still out there somewhere, and he's got something going on, and Ron Paul, he's got a lot of supporters out there too. And so, depending on who you ask, you got 4 different opinions. But you got these enemies, you got these adversaries, and they are sure that they are destroying you. They are sure that they are winning. They are sure that you're going to get wiped out. And the devil believes right now. You say, why does the devil keep up the fight? Hasn't he ever read the last of the book of Revelation? Yes, he has, but he chooses not to believe it. You know, he is one stubborn son of a gun that more than anything that's ever been out there. He keeps it up and keeps it up and keeps it up and keeps it up. And he is going to fight right to the end. And he says, I may not be able to win, but I'm going to take as many down with me as I can. And he wants you to be of that number. You realize that this morning. He wants to sift you as wheat, like Jesus said to Peter. He wants to take you and destroy you. And if he can't take you to hell, at least he can make you ineffective and not let you lead anybody else to Jesus Christ. Let your testimony be washed up and they can say, hey, maybe we're not gonna avoid hell, but we're going to take as many down with us as we can. And so they think they're your enemies. And to them, it's a proof of perdition. It's a proof of your destruction. But he says to you, it's a sign of your salvation. Look with me at a moment, John chapter 16, verse 33. You say, I don't want these things, and you don't want Jesus Christ. These things have I spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation. But be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. In the world you will have tribulation. You will have problems. You will have heartaches. You will have trials. If you don't, something's wrong with you. Do you realize that? If you have no enemies for the cause of Christ, then you're not living the life for Christ in some way the way you should. Because my Bible says that in the world you will have tribulation. But don't worry about it. I have overcome the world. Let me give you another verse, 2 Timothy 3:12. Yes, and all who desire to live godly in Christ will suffer what? Persecution. Will suffer persecution. Now, I'm not talking self-inflicted. Okay? Don't go acting like a jerk and do something stupid, and then when you get in trouble for it, that's not what we're talking about. We're not talking about tribulation because of disobedience. We're talking about tribulation because of righteousness. All those who desire to live godly in Christ will promise suffer persecution. Just going to leave that up there for a moment and let you soak that in. Because what does he say here? To Psalm, it's perdition. It's a proof of perdition. But to you, it's a proof of your salvation. If you are having trials and if you are having tribulation this morning, praise God, that's an evidence of your salvation. And he says it right there. It's a proof of your salvation, and that is from God. So stand strong in the trials with others. Stand fast, aiming the same direction with others. Thirdly, stand for Christ with others. Verse 29. For to you it has been granted on behalf of Christ not only to believe on Him, but to suffer for His sake, having the same conflict in which you saw in me and now hear in me. You are called to suffer, according to verse 29. You are granted. It is a gift. You are given the privilege of suffering for Jesus Christ. You probably don't look at it that way. You probably don't say, oh, wonderful, a gift came in the mail. What is it? Persecution, trials, and tribulation. What Paul says, he says, you have been given the opportunity to suffer for Jesus Christ. It's on behalf of Christ, for His sake. You're not only just to believe on Him. Salvation is not just, I believe, it's a fire escape from hell. Salvation is a fire escape from hell, but it is a fast track to living for Jesus Christ. You can suffer or testify. It's a testimony for His sake. There is no greater testimony than a believer going through trials and testing and tribulation and persecution and destruction and saying, God is my witness. I will not move. Some of you have read that Iranian pastor that they've been threatening with execution. One Iranian pastor who believes in Christ, he's a minority in his country, and what is he doing? He's giving a testimony for Jesus Christ all around the world. There's one former college quarterback, now a pro quarterback for the Denver Broncos. What is he known for all around the world? Is it his throwing? Is it his running? Is it his quick thinking? No. It's his testimony for Jesus Christ. So much that he's making people mad. He's having people saying, he shouldn't be doing that. And they're criticizing him, lamb blastering. And you know what I say to this? Brother Tim, go to it. Go to it. Praise God. What did we have the last? Oh yeah, we had another quarterback role model. He was really good at dogfighting. And we got this one for womanizing, and we've got this one for drunkenness, and we've got this one for drug addiction. Wow, isn't it sad that we've got one for giving praise to Christ? What are we coming to? But praise God, his testimony goes around the world. What does he say? He says here that you have been given the same conflict which you saw in me and now is... How did Paul start his ministry in Philippi? Oh, in jail. Remember that? Go back to Acts chapter 16. Paul started his ministry in Philippi by being arrested, by being beaten, and by being jailed. Great way. That's what we tell every church planter. Go into town, get arrested, get beaten, and get put in jail. That's how to start a church. That's what Paul did. Why? Because Paul did what every church planter needs to do, and that is preach the gospel. And it brings affliction, it brings conflict, it brings perdition, more to it. He says, you have the opportunity to suffer for him and also for his sake. And he says, that same conflict that you saw in me and you now hear is still in me. And where is Paul? He is in Rome, in jail, after being beaten. And what's he saying to the Philippians? Strive together. Strive together. Work together, band together, put all of your energy, put all of your might, put all of your strength, put all of your knowledge, put all of your wisdom together for the gospel of Jesus Christ, because the world needs it desperately. And whether there's an earthquake, whether there's a flood, whether there's a tornado, whether there's a nuclear holocaust, at that point, nothing else will matter. Aside from the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let me ask you, are you willing to strive for the gospel? Are you willing to strive for the gospel? That is still active today. This isn't just for Paul's day, and it's not just for the Middle East, or it's not just for Europe. It's for United States, it's for Canada, it's for South America, it's for the world. Are you striving for Jesus Christ? Let's just bow together for a moment. In a moment we're going to go downstairs and join with our brothers and sisters for the Lord's Supper. But I just want you to answer that question in your own heart. Are you striving for the gospel? Can't strive for the gospel if you don't believe the gospel. If you know Jesus Christ is your Savior. And may I just challenge you, wherever God has put you, whatever vocation God has put you, whatever neighborhood, whatever setting, whatever educational institution, whatever it may be, are you striving for the gospel of Jesus Christ? That's what He's asking of us. Let's pray. Father, thank You this morning for Your Word. Thank You for the opportunity we have to serve You with our lives, just as Paul did, just as the Philippians did. And Father, we thank You for loving us, and we thank You that You have given us the gospel. Thank You for giving us persecution and tribulation and trials. May we rejoice in them because it's a proof and evidence of our salvation. And Father, may we strive together, not only as a body here, but with other bodies and with our different groups, and may we serve Jesus Christ with all of our heart and all of our soul and all of our mind. And we'll give You thanks and praise in Jesus' name. Amen.